Thank you. Appreciate that. Amen. Well, welcome to Philly, right? And these folks know Dominic Pinicetti here, huh? So, hey, yesterday, the preacher picks me up at the airport. And we're talking and having a good time. And you know, you get welcome to Philadelphia in different ways. And I had never dialed 911 in my life. But yesterday I did. This is the truth, huh, preacher? We're driving along, we're clipping 65, 70 miles an hour, and right in front of us, maybe 150 yards, this car explodes off the side of the, you know, look at that! You know, we pulled over, and I go, what did I dial? You know, and straight at 0000, but here it's 911. So I dial 911, and he pulls the car over. And I said, you talk to them. I don't know what to say. And I went running out back down the interstate. And as I'm running along, an old pot-bellied preacher, these young guys are passing me. Is that true? It's only in Philly. Everybody's trying to help, you know. They're probably getting there to rob the people, but I'm getting there to... Yeah. And so as I'm running towards it, guy gets out of the car and he looks over the side of the rail and starts throwing stuff out of his backpack. Not a good sign. and so they got a hold of it, and the preacher came up, and he even passed me, you know. And cars going like this, and people dodging parts of the car. And the guy was okay, but only in Philadelphia. But, you know, what impressed me is they went to help. And they didn't know that guy, and police shows up, looks like, man, the Lone Ranger. I'd never seen a cop so decorated. And about, he's big, was he big? He was, and he got out and he looked at that guy and he said, you all right? And he said, yeah. And these other guys told him to sit down. We got back in the car, but I enjoy Philly every time I come here. So, but I'm glad to be here today. I'm like the lightning bug that flew into the fan backwards. I'm delighted to be here. That'll sink on you a little bit, amen? But what I want you to do this morning with me, by way of missions, I'll introduce myself and I'll get started. And what I want to do, because I enjoy what I do, don't you? I enjoy eating. I enjoy Dunkin' Donuts. Thank you for giving me a gift certificate for Dunkin' Donuts. I was there at 6 a.m. this morning. I love blueberry Pop-Tarts, but they don't have them. So I had a blueberry muffin about as big as my head. Now that's big. It's one of those ones that it says it's a health food one. Is that, how many have seen that? This is how they do it. You know, a healthy muffin, what's it called, gluten-free. But when you get that thing, there's about a pound of sugar on top of it. Am I right? And so I got that this morning, and I enjoy that. But I'm just delighted, and I love what I do. So this morning, what we're going to do is start, and I need somebody to help me. Brother Troy, I knew him before he had a goatee and beard, amen? And he's known, now Troy, I don't need to come down, but you wave at me when I've got about 2 minutes to go. Would you stop me at about 1:30? Okay, all right, but you stop me. And we're just going to start with this, all right? Now, I've been in the ministry 42 years. Got married on June 7th. My honeymoon was drive to the first church where I was at, and I was there for 20 years. And I grew up as a youth pastor there. Went there as a school teacher. In 6 months, I became the youth pastor. One of my best friends, I took his, and him and I were together for 20 years in ministry. He was in Sal Unesi's church as an evangelist. I don't know where that church is, it's up here somewhere. But Bill Behrens, anybody ever run into Bill Behrens? Okay, him and I were one of my best friends, and he was the biggest jokester that ever lived. And when I was going to the mission field, he's coming here to start his evangelism. We're preaching in Boston, Massachusetts. He starts crying. Can you imagine Bill Behrens crying? Pulls off the interstate, squeals into the grass. He said, I just can't go on. You're leaving me in the ministry after 20 years. My life is over. And he got a hand grenade and threw it at my feet. He says, we're going to go out together. I jumped out of that car, rolled down the ditch, and he's up there just laughing hard as he can. For 20 years, he always got me. But he's a good friend from this area. He preached for me in New Guinea in our ministries. God's blessed us there. And what we've done in 1995, after 20 years in the States, the Lord led my wife and I into missions. And I have 7 children, one's in heaven already. 5 of those are adopted. from Bus Ministry in the Chicago area. My youngest daughter, you'll see her on the prayer card they're going to hand out here to you today, Selena, 17, going on 27. She was given to me when she was 30 days old in a sack. Family did not want her. The mother didn't want to take care of them, and her clan or tribe were in our church, and they said, we want to give you something. And my wife had prayed, because we had no children at that time, and we never had our own little baby girl, and for a year she prayed for that. And we had devotions all the time, and I was 48 years old, you know, I'm done with kids, I'm ready for grandkids. But God gave us that little girl, and that's how I've lost my hair, and so she graduates this year. But in our ministries in New Guinea, you'll see later on this morning and or tonight, we started with one church with 40 people. And when we left 5 years later, handed over to a national pastor, the church was averaging 512 every Sunday morning for the preaching service. So God blessed in that. We had a Christian school of about 150. We had a Bible college of 85. And I believe in giving everything to the national pastors. I don't believe in just going over there to own everything. So that's the way I operate now, that one church. Now we have 8 churches. Yesterday we had a little over 3,400 in church. Pastor Tao called me. I'm preaching revival there next Sunday morning. I'll be preaching on the edge of Port Moresby, where today it is 92 degrees. You know, it's midnight there now. And I love that heat. But anyway, and we had a little over 3,400 people in church and had 17 saved. And we praise the Lord for that. And those 8 churches, we have a church, our last church we started in Cairns, Australia. God's blessed that work. All these works have been given to national pastors. But to make these ministries start and to make them operate, it takes prayer, but it takes support. It takes people to see and catch the vision and the purpose. And this morning, I'm going to start in 2 Corinthians chapter 8 just for a couple of minutes. Then I'm going to move right on in to look at Mark chapter 14, verse 9, and give you a few principles about missions. This is a missions church, all right? I met with the pastor yesterday. We're driving. You have missionaries. I don't know how many you support, preacher. I know you have them in the budget. And the thing is, God blesses missions, all right? I cannot put it in English. I can't put it, you know, I can speak a little bit of Spanish, you know. I can speak a little bit of hillbilly. I can talk like I'm from Philadelphia and get a cheesesteak. I can do all those things. Or from Minnesota, eh? I can do all those things. But no matter where I travel, God uses people like this church to get other churches started around the world. Amen? And all of our churches in Papua New Guinea, me Adam talk pidgin lick lick, you hear a name belong me now, me Adam talk Papa God, you savvy, I'll get that. So I have that language down. But when I preach there or preach here, everybody, I teach them the same. I preach the same word of God. And it crosses all cultures. So what I want to do today is show you just a little bit about what God wants us to do in missions. I know you get it. I know you understand it. And some of this may be old to you, but I just want to encourage you and have you understand that God wants to bless your church. And I think everybody here wants God's blessing in their life. Do they not? And to do that, let me teach you a little acronym, L-O-R-D. Say that with me. L-O-R-D. Now, what does that spell? Now, here's what the L means. It spells Lord. Is to listen to God's word. O means to obey God's word. R means to respect and respond to God's word. Woo, woo, woo. What? Respect and respond to God's word. Somebody thinks the preachers write the Bible, but they don't. They got to. They're like the newspaper boy. They got to deliver what it already says. Amen. So if you learn to listen, obey, and respond, and at the end you do what God's word says, it'll change your life. Now I got that outline off of a 12-year-old sixth grade student at Redlands. Sixth grade school I taught 10 years ago. So as we teach today, let that hover over our thoughts. Look what the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 1. Moreover, brethren, that's us, we do you to wit, or as is to know, the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia, how that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded into the riches of their liberality. For to their power, I bear record, yea, and beyond their power, they were willing of themselves. Paul saying they were willing. Nobody made them do it. Nobody pushed them to do it. All right. Now watch this. Verse 4. Praying us with much entreaty that we would receive the gift. There it is. the gift and this grace that was given to them. We want you to know about it. That take upon us the fellowship of ministering to the saints. And this they did, not as we hoped, but first gave their own selves unto the Lord and to us by the will of God. So is this God's will, what I'm about to speak on this morning? Now watch very carefully. Now look at verse 7. Therefore, as ye abound in everything, in faith, in utterance, and knowledge. Boy, you can have the faith to move a mountain. You can have the knowledge to know every Bible verse in the Bible. Okay? And you can say it. You can utter it. And in all diligence, and you are diligent, and in all your love to us, you got that love, you really love us, see that you abound, ye abound in this grace also. What is this grace? We call it faith promise giving. You all have faith promise cards here that the preacher's going to talk about. And I want you to notice something here. These people were in a verse 2, a great trial of affliction. It says they were deep poverty. And it says that they abounded. They were not afraid. They had to give what God put in their heart to give. And verse 3 says, and they gave to their power. And then some by faith gave beyond what they thought they had. And God blessed in a great way. But before he blessed, look at verse 5. And this they did, not as we hoped, but first gave themselves to who? The Lord. Isn't that great? But first, but unto us, by the will of God. So it's God's will for you to do this. But you got to do what God puts in your heart to do. And God will bless in all this. And what are you speaking about this morning? There's 7 billion people plus in this world. And there are people that out of that group, probably 5 billion has never heard anything about the Lord Jesus Christ. I've traveled a lot, and the world is not America, okay? I lived in Australia and New Guinea. New Guinea's looking for God. Australia could care less about God. America's still looking for God, but she's slowed down a lot since 19, whenever I was born. I don't like living in the past. I want to dwell in the future, amen. And God has given us a little revival. God has showed himself in this country. You're going to see how God shows himself. And may we be part of that. But let's listen to God's word. Let's obey it. Let's respond to it. And let's do what he puts in our hearts to do today concerning this faith promise missions. God blesses it. In a great way. Our church in Australia, I'm going to brag on them a little bit, even our churches in New Guinea, we started a church from scratch. Our first Sunday service, we had 7 people, and we voted to take on our first missionary before we were ever chartered. My wife thought I was crazy. Where are we going to get the money? God will provide. God will provide. And we had 30 days. I said, and the church voted right there, and we voted for $100 a month. We didn't have 10 pennies in the offering. But you know what? God met every need. And every year since we've started the church, I handed over to another pastor 5 years ago, a new pastor's been there. We take on a new missionary every year. Now, Australia is different than here. There's not the independent Baptists. There's only a total of 85 Baptist churches like this one in all of Australia. And so it's hard to get support for the missionaries from Australia. All we do is support American or Australian missionaries. And that new pastor, he's older there now. He's been there 5 years almost. Instead of taking on a new missionary every year, he did that, but in supporting only 100 a month, he supports him 300 a month. I was in shock. And I went back there to preach last year, and he told me that, and I looked at the people that I discipled and planted, and they're still all there in the church. And preacher, you've got to start at giving, but he's taking us to the next level. And God's blessed, and God's blessed. Little boy, I got it on my phone if you want to see it. His name's David Vo. I led him to the Lord. He's a Vietnamese. You talk about choppy English. I led him to the Lord in Australia. How many remember the girl, a picture, Look Magazine, the last century, number one picture of the year, of the whole century, that girl with napalm in the Vietnam village? How many guys remember that picture? It was all, I mean, it's famous. Well, that lady lives up in Canada, and she's probably a couple years older than me. She speaks around the world. Well, her granddaughter is a Christian, went to Faithway Baptist College looking for a husband. A guy I led to the Lord 6 years ago, discipled for 3 years, is now serving as a missionary of our church in Cairns, Australia. Now get this, in Vietnam, because he's from Vietnam, he can get in and out of Vietnam. And she went over there to visit, looking to work in an underground church, and them two people met. And the only person that knows both of them is me. And I've been trying to put them together for 2 years. And they got together. They're getting married. And he's going to start a Vietnamese church in Cambodia along the riverfront there. And our church in Australia is going to support him. Now watch this. That none of that would happen unless it be people like you, people like our church in Australia, did what God put on their hearts to do concerning this grace. Okay? This grace bestowed on the churches. Now, Paul says, let me tell you a little bit about it. Amen? Deep poverty, had nothing going on. But they did this, and more than we hoped, they did this because it was God's will. And they did it because God put it in their heart to do. And see, verse 7, look at verse 7. See, not all them other ones, but you abound in this grace also. So get involved in it. Amen. I will go back to where I started this morning. I love Dunkin' Donuts coffee. I like blueberry muffins. I like blueberry Pop-Tarts. And when I get a chance, I will abound in all three. Amen. But if you want God to really encourage you, I'm not talking about giving to get, but you want God to really see, you want to see the blessings of God around you and what's with your church and what's with your family. Just do it as God's, what His Word says. Amen. Let's go to Mark chapter 14, verse 9. We'll go real quick in this. I've got about 15 more minutes or so. Let's take a look at this. And Jesus is preaching here, and Jesus is talking here, and He's going to talk about a young lady. And let's take a look at her in verse 9. And I know this is kind of a different verse for faith promise giving. But verily, Jesus said, I say unto you, wheresoever the gospel shall be preached throughout the whole world, this also that she hath done shall be spoken of for a memorial to her. Wherever the gospel's taken, what Mary has done has to be preached along with the gospel for what she had done. Now, folks, that gets my little antenna up. Amen. Gets me interested a little bit in what's going on. So I want to see what Jesus was talking about. And every one of my points this morning, if you're taking notes, start with the letter O. And I want you to do this. And it says in verse 8 that she hath done what she could, that she come aforehand to anoint my body to the burying. He'd been working with the disciples for 3 years. They weren't catching on it. They, as we say in Australia, they were not very cluey. But she'd been around this Christ. She'd been around the gospel. She'd been around the Lord. And you know, when you look at her, and every time she's mentioned in Scripture, you know, I believe she's mentioned 9 times. 3 of the times you see Mary mentioned that she'll be at the feet of Jesus getting instruction in Luke 10:39. You see her 3 more times that she's at the feet of Jesus in John 12:3, looking for service to serve the Lord. Three other times at the foot of Jesus in Luke or in John 11:32, she's getting comfort from him. She was always around Jesus. Now she was Martha, the sister, right? How many remember this thought about Martha? Jesus said, "Girl, you need to back up and slow down, take a deep breath. You're much cumbered about. You're a worrywart." All right. You quit picking on your sister, is what he's saying in Philadelphia. And you leave her alone, you can serve me all the peanut butter and jelly and hot dogs you want. And that is good. And that is great. But she's chosen a better part where she's going to listen. And she's going to trust. And I'm working on her heart like I'm working on yours. Now you need to take a deep breath. It's basically what he told Martha. Amen. But God didn't say, let's remember Martha. He said, let's remember Mary. Wherever the gospel's preached, let's look at her and use her as a guide. Listen, let's obey, let's respond, and do what she did. Number one, she was an ordinary person. Look what the Bible says here in my text. Look at verse 3. What do you mean, ordinary person? And being in Bethany, in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at meat, there came a woman having an alabaster box of ointment, of spikenard. Now watch this. Very precious. That means it's like a 401k. back in those days, didn't have the welfare or social services or Medicare or Medicaid and things like that. So for investments that you could sell now and sell 5 or 6 years down the road, this like gold and land, and usually this ointment here, this alabaster box, the perfumes would only go up in value. And the longer it was, the more it was aged, the more it was worth. And this was kind of her inheritance. This was when people would die, the wives would go sell this and live off of it for a while. And I want you to know it was very precious. Now, she was an ordinary person. Jesus didn't give her name there, but she wanted to do something special for the Lord. She knew the scriptures. You know, I've learned over the years, people learn the scriptures, usually end up doing the right thing in the right way at the right time. And she'd been sitting at the feet of Jesus, and she knew that the crucifixion was coming, and she knew that he had to die on the cross, and she had knew that the Old Testament said that he had to be anointed, getting ready to die on the cross for the bearing. And so she took that alabaster box, just an ordinary person, listening to Jesus, listening to God's word. You know, if I can encourage you, she was involved in instruction. Three times in the Bible where you see her name comes up, she was listening to the Lord teach. Three other times she was comforted by the Lord. She didn't understand everything when Lazarus died, and the Lord had to comfort her. Two other times he comforted her here when she was attacked by the disciples, not physically, but they were getting all over her, and Jesus said that was enough. And then there, when he come out of the tomb, he comforted her again. She's always around what's right. But she was just an ordinary person. Can I say this? And she stood alone with the decisions she made. She didn't worry about what everybody thought. She worried about what God put in her heart. And she did. She was ordinary. Number two, if I can point this out to you, and I want you to see it with me. Not only was she ordinary, Mary was an observant person. Look at verse 8. She hath done what she could. She has come beforehand to anoint the body to the burying. She realized it was time. The mother knuckleheads was sitting there eating their food, and Lazarus the thief, or not Lazarus the thief, but Judas the thief, the bean counter, was calling out with the other disciples. They weren't thinking this, folks. They were saying it to her. They murmured again, "How dumb can you be? What are you doing? You busted that whole inheritance." Now, some folks value that as a year's worth or 2 years worth of salary in the United States today. So the average income in North Philly is what per person? About $50,000 a year, maybe $55,000, I don't know. So how would you like to take something between $110,000 and $200,000 and break it over somebody's head of value and just give it to him? When's the last time you've given somebody, I don't know what an ounce of gold is, when's the last time you give somebody 3 or 4 pounds of gold? When's the last time you wrote a check out for $110,000 and just give it to somebody because God put it on your heart to do for the future, getting you ready to die on the cross, you see? And that didn't make sense to Judas. Well, I don't believe he was even saved. It didn't make sense to the other disciples there because they couldn't see what Mary could see. Because you know why? She observed what Jesus was saying and she believed it. Mary had a heart and she had a habit to worship. And I want to encourage you, when she sat at Jesus' feet, she just wasn't listening to the story. She was thinking it through. She was applying it to her personal life, and God blessed her in a great way. Let's go to Luke chapter 10 for just a moment. Could you go there with me? Let's look at verse 39. Luke chapter 10, let's take a look at verse 39. All right, let's take a look at that and see what it says. The Bible says, "And she had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was cumbered about much serving and came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she help me. And Jesus answered and said, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things." Boy, you worry about, can I say this? Some of the dumbest things. You worry about if you're dressed just right. You worried about if you just look just right. You worried about if the bread's hot enough. You're worried about if the cheese is thick enough. You're worried about what you've got to do. And you're busy, 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 busy. And all that's good. But, verse 42, "And you're troubled with many things. But this one thing, this is what you need. And Mary hath chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from her." And this is what the good part is. She's observing in her heart. She's going to do something great for me. And she has the faith to do it. Folks, that's what faith promise is. I want to say this in my preaching here today and in Pastor Love's preaching. Nowhere in Scripture will you ever find Jesus or God asking anybody to give anything to Him unless they already have it. Nowhere in Scripture. You think of the woman at the well, or you think of the widow that taking care of Elijah and then Elisha. And you think of the widow whose husband died and had two sons and the oil. I can go on and on through Scripture. The little boy and feeding the 5,000. He had five little loaves and two fishes. Nowhere in Scripture. So you got to observe what's going on. She's just an ordinary person that observed what Jesus was doing. She knew what direction He was going in. And she'd made a decision to do what God put in her heart to do. Not only was she an ordinary person, not only was she an observant person. Number three, Mary was an oblivious person. Look what it says in verse 4. The Bible says in our text back in Mark, if you'll go back there with me, verse 4, chapter 14. And there were some that had indignation within themselves and said, why was this waste of the ointment made? Why did she do this? Well, she loves the Lord. She wants that gospel to get out. She wants Him to get where He needs to be. For it might have been sold for a 300 pence that had been given to the poor. And they murmured against her. They didn't understand. But Mary was oblivious to what they thought. She could care less what they were after. They were calling her a fool for the Lord. They were calling her a waster of money. And you know what, folks? I want to say this about her. She was wide open. Okay? If God put it in her heart to do it, she did it. Do you ever meet somebody wide open and they get in trouble? Huh? Have you met somebody wide open for the Lord and get in trouble? I've never met anybody like that. Now, I've seen guys go wide open and get speeding tickets, but that's not what I'm talking about. All right. I'm talking about people that have dedicated their life to God. Now, I'm not a missionary that begs. I've never done it. I never will that. Where God guides, He will what? Provide. He's already at tomorrow. And this lady took all that ointment that she had, and she poured it on Jesus, getting ready to the crucifixion. How many believe God would bless that lady's life till the day she died? Right? That's what that verse is about. Wherever the gospel's spoken, it is a memorial for her. Not only for her, but for what she had done. She done what she could, why she had time to do it, and she did it in God's way. And folks, I'm telling you, she's oblivious to what anyone else thought. You know, when I was in serving, I started a church in the mission field there, and I was going to give it over to another missionary and going to start another one. And the church was probably running about 100 people and had its own building, and it had been a 4-year process. And I took this missionary there, and I mean, he was really excited. And we had running water. It was in another foreign third world, and we had fans and we had pews, and we didn't have concrete on the floor yet. We were sitting on the dust, but we were going to get it. But we had the walls up, you know, seats about 100 people, and we had a little parking lot, and we had built that thing, and we praised God for it. And He wants to come take the church, and He brought her the next Sunday. And she got in there and said, there's no air conditioning here. And she said, well, the Walmart is a 4-hour drive from here. It was a Price Mart in that country. And she said, honey, that's too far to go shopping. If there's no air conditioning here, I don't believe we need to come here into ministry. Mm-mm-mm. She's no different than those 12 disciples murmuring against Mary. She'd missed the picture. By the way, I took that offer off the table and gave it to two 30-year-old assistant pastors at another church, and they took that church today. That church is big as this one today in that foreign field. God has blessed that thing. Folks, hey, you can observe things too, right? You can see things too, and you understand things too. The Bible says it's been better for them never had to have known the way of righteousness than to have known it and get entangled therein again. That's not only dealing with sin, that's dealing with decisions we make as Christians. She was oblivious. Thank you, sir. The last O is this. I want you to see this with me as I close this thought. The last thing is this. She was obedient. Look at verse 6. The Bible says, let her alone. Why trouble ye her? Hath wrought a good work on me. She was obedient. She did what I told her to do. Verse 8, she hath done what she could. She couldn't preach. She couldn't teach. She kind of let's stay back in that culture and that custom. So she did what she could. Now, folks, I just want to tell you something. She just did not give a few ounces. She gave the whole thing. She didn't hold back. An ordinary person. But she had a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. She was an observant person. And she was observing to do the things of Christ and for Christ. She was an oblivious person. She could care less what others thought. She was obedient. And she did what the Lord Jesus Christ put on her heart to do. And she, like the ones back in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, she went over and above and beyond. Not only did she give to her power, but she gave over that. Not because she had to, not because she wanted to, but God put that will in her heart because that was the Lord's will. That's what faith promise is. This is part of it. I want to encourage you as a missionary and as a pastor, and I think I've been in this for 42 years, almost, going on 43. And I've watched God bless in a wonderful way, and it's not me that God's blessed. It's the direction of His Word. So can I encourage you as we close? L-O-R-D. Listen to God's Word, obey it, and respond, and do. And you, like Mary, you'll have a legacy that you'll leave, a memory that you'll have, like it was recorded in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, Ben Salem Baptist Church. They were here, they were here, they were here. But they gave for the cause of Christ. They didn't count the cost, but they gave because what God put on their hearts to do. And all God's people said, amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning for your word. We thank you for the opportunity you've given us to meet. And Lord, for the desire that you've put in these folks' hearts to come to Sunday school. Lord, where they can get instructed, where their hearts can become involved. And Lord, where they'll make a difference in lives, not only here, but around the world. I pray that you be with us this next hour. Lord, that we'll look at your word and you'll guide us, you'll encourage us, you'll challenge us, Lord, and convict our hearts for your honor and your glory. And Father, we pray these things in your name. Amen.